The International Significance of Comrade Mao Zedong's Theory of People's War by Lin Biao. The Chinese Revolution is a continuation of the Great October Revolution. The road of the October Revolution is the common road for all people's revolutions. The Chinese Revolution and the October Revolution have in common the following basic characteristics. 1. Both were led by the working class with the Marxist-Leninist Party at its nucleus. 2. Both were based on the workers-peasant alliance. 3. In both cases, state power was seized through violent revolution and the dictatorship of the proletariat was established. 4. In both cases, the socialist system was built after victory in the revolution. 5. Both were component parts of the proletarian world revolution. Naturally, the Chinese Revolution had its own peculiar characteristics. The October Revolution took place in imperialist Russia, but the Chinese Revolution broke out in a semi-colonial and semi-feudal country. The former was a proletarian socialist revolution, while the latter developed into a socialist revolution after the complete victory of the new democratic revolution. The October Revolution began with armed uprisings in the cities and then spread to the countryside, while the Chinese Revolution won nationwide victory through the encirclement of the cities from the rural areas and the final capture of the cities. Comrade Mao Zedong's great merit lies in the fact that he has succeeded in integrating the universal truths of Marxism-Leninism with a concrete practice of the Chinese Revolution and has enriched and developed Marxism-Leninism by his masterly generalization and summation of the experience gained during the Chinese people's protracted revolutionary struggle. Comrade Mao Zedong's theory of people's war has proved by the long practice of the Chinese Revolution to be in accord with the objective laws of such wars and to be invincible. It has not only been valid for China, it is a great contribution to the revolutionary struggles of the oppressed nations and peoples throughout the world. The People's War, led by the Chinese Communist Party, comprising the War of Resistance and the Revolutionary Civil Wars, lasted for 22 years. It constitutes the most drawn-out and most complex people's war led by the proletariat in modern history, and it has been the richest in experience. In the last analysis, the Marxist-Leninist theory of proletarian revolution is the theory of the seizure of state power by revolutionary violence. The theory of countering war against the people by people's war, as Marx so aptly put it, force is the midwife of every old society, pregnant with a new one. On the basis of the lessons derived from the People's War in China, that Comrade Mao Zedong, using the simplest and most vivid language, advanced the famous thesis that political power grows out of the barrel of a gun. He clearly pointed out, the seizure of power by armed force, the settlement of the issue by war, is the central task and the highest form of revolution. This Marxist-Leninist principle of revolution holds good universally for China and for all other countries. War is the product of imperialism and the system of exploitation of man by man. Lenin said that, quote, war is always and everywhere begun by the exploiters themselves, by ruling and oppressing classes, end quote. So long as imperialism and the system of exploitation of man by man exist, the imperialists and reactionaries would invariably rely on armed force to maintain their reactionary rule and impose war on the oppressed nations and people. This is an objective law independent of man's will. In the world today, all the imperialists headed by the United States and their lackeys, without exception, are strengthening their state machinery, and especially their armed forces. U.S. imperialism, in particular, is carrying out armed aggression and suppression everywhere. What should the oppressed nations and the oppressed people do in the face of wars of aggression and armed suppression by the imperialists and their lackeys? Should they submit and remain slaves in perpetuity? Or should they rise in resistance and fight for their liberation? Comrade Mao Zedong answered this question in vivid terms. He said that, after long investigation and study, the Chinese people discovered that all the imperialists and their lackeys, quote, have swords in their hands and are out to kill. The people have come to understand this and so act after the same fashion, end quote. This is called doing unto them what they do unto us. In the last analysis, whether one dares to wage a tit-for-tat struggle against armed aggression and suppression by the imperialists and their lackeys, whether one dares to fight a people's war against them, means whether one dares to embark on revolution. This is the most effective touchstone for distinguishing genuine from fake revolutionaries and Marxist-Leninists. In view of the fact that some people were afflicted with fear of the imperialists and reactionaries, Comrade Mao-Tse Tung put forward his famous thesis that, quote, imperialists and all reactionaries are paper tigers, he said. All reactionaries are paper tigers. In appearance, the reactionaries are terrifying, but in reality, they are not so powerful. From a long-term point of view, it is not the reactionaries, but the people who are really powerful. The history of the People's War in China and other countries provides conclusive evidence that the growth of the People's Revolutionary Forces from weak and small beginnings into strong and large forces is a universal law of development of People's War. A People's War inevitably meets with many difficulties, with ups and downs and setbacks in the course of its development, but no force can alter its general trend toward inevitable triumph. Comrade Mao Zedong points out that we must despise the enemy strategically and take full account of him tactically. To despise the enemy strategically is an elementary requirement for a revolutionary. Without the courage to despise the enemy and without daring to win, it will be simply impossible to make revolution and wage a people's war, let alone to achieve victory. It is also very important for revolutionaries to take full account of the enemy tactically. It is likewise impossible to win in a people's war without taking full account of the enemy tactically and without examining the concrete conditions, without being prudent and giving great attention to the study of the art of struggle, and without adopting appropriate forms of struggle in the concrete practice of the revolution in each country and with regard to each concrete problem of struggle. Dialectical and historical materialism teaches us that what is important is primarily is not that which at the given moment seems to be durable, and yet is already beginning to die away, but that which is arising and developing, even though at the given moment it may not appear to be durable, for only that which is arising and developing is invincible. Why can the apparently weak newborn forces always triumph over the decadent forces which appear so powerful? The reason is that truth is on their side, and that the masses are on their side, while the reactionary classes are always divorced from the masses and set themselves against the masses. This has been borne out by the victory of the Chinese Revolution, by the history of all revolutions, the whole history of the class struggle, and the entire history of mankind. The imperialists are extremely afraid of Comrade Mao Zedong's thesis that, quote, imperialism and all reactionaries are paper tigers, end quote, and the revisionists are extremely hostile to it. They all oppose and attack the thesis, and the Philistines follow suit by ridiculing it. But all this cannot in the least diminish its importance. The light of truth cannot be dimmed by anybody. Comrade Mao Zedong's theory of people's war solves not only the problem of daring to fight a people's war, but also that of how to wage it. Comrade Mao Zedong is a great statesman and military scientist, proficient at directing war in accordance with its laws. By the line and policies, the strategy and tactics be formulated for people's war, he led the Chinese people in steering the ship of the people's war past all hidden reefs to the shores of victory in the most complicated and difficult conditions. It must be emphasized that Comrade Mao Zedong's theory of the establishment of rural revolutionary base areas and the encirclement of the cities from the countryside is of outstanding and universal practical importance for the present revolutionary struggles of all the oppressed nations and peoples, and particularly for the revolutionary struggles of the oppressed nations and peoples in Asia, Africa, and Latin America against imperialism and its lackeys. Many countries and peoples in Asia, Africa, and Latin America are now being subjected to aggression and enslavement on a serious scale by the imperialists headed by the United States and their lackeys. The basic political and economic conditions in many of these countries have many similarities to those that prevailed in old China. As in China, the peasant question is extremely important in these regions. The peasants constitute the main force of the National Democratic Revolution against the imperialists and their lackeys. In committing aggression against these countries, the imperialists usually begin by seizing the big cities and the main lines of communication, but they are unable to bring the vast countryside completely under their control. The countryside, and the countryside alone, can provide the broad areas in which the revolutionaries can maneuver freely. The countryside, and the countryside alone, can provide the revolutionary bases from which the revolutionaries can go forward to final victory. Precisely for this reason, Comrade Mao Zedong's theory of establishing revolutionary base areas in the rural districts and encircling the cities from the countryside is attracting more and more attention among the people in these regions. Taking the entire globe, if North America and Western Europe can be called the cities of the world, then Asia, Africa, and Latin America constitute the rural areas of the world. Since World War II, the proletarian revolutionary movement has for various reasons been temporarily held back in the North American and West European capitalist countries, while the people's revolutionary movement in Asia, Africa, and Latin America has been growing vigorously. In a sense, the contemporary world revolution also presents a picture of the encirclement of cities by the rural areas. In the final analysis, the whole cause of world revolution hinges on the revolutionary struggles of the Asian, African, and Latin American peoples who make up the overwhelming majority of the world's population. The socialist countries should regard it as their internationalist duty to support the people's revolutionary struggles in Asia, Africa, and Latin America. The October Revolution opened up a new era in the revolution of the oppressed nations. The victory of the October Revolution built a bridge between the socialist revolution of the proletariat of the West and the National Democratic Revolution of the colonial and semi-colonial countries of the East. The Chinese Revolution has successfully solved the problem of how to link up the National Democratic with the socialist revolution in the colonial and semi-colonial countries. Comrade Mao Zedong has pointed out that, in the epoch since the October Revolution, anti-imperialist revolutions in any colonial or semi-colonial country is no longer part of the old bourgeois or capitalist world revolution, but is a part of the new world revolution, the proletarian socialist world revolution. Comrade Mao Zedong has formulated a complete theory of the new democratic revolution. He indicated that this revolution, which is different from all others, can only be, nay, must be, a revolution against imperialism, feudalism, and bureaucrat capitalism waged by the broad masses of the people under the leadership of the proletariat. This means that the revolution can only be, nay, must be, led by the proletariat in the genuinely revolutionary party armed with Marxism-Leninism and by no other class or party. This means that the revolution embraces in its ranks not only the workers, peasants, and the urban petty bourgeoisie, but also the national bourgeoisie and other patriotic and anti-imperialist Democrats. This means, finally, that the revolution is directed against imperialism, feudalism, and bureaucrat capitalism. The new democratic revolution leads to socialism and not to capitalism. Comrade Mao Zedong's theory of the new democratic revolution is the Marxist-Leninist theory of revolution by stages, as well as the Marxist-Leninist theory of uninterrupted revolution. Comrade Mao Zedong made a correct distinction between the two revolutionary stages, i.e., the National Democratic and the Socialist revolutions. At the same time, he correctly and closely linked the two. The National Democratic Revolution is the necessary preparation for the Socialist Revolution, and the Socialist Revolution is the inevitable sequel to the National Democratic Revolution. There is no great wall between the two revolutionary stages, but the Socialist Revolution is only possible after the completion of the National Democratic Revolution. The more thorough the National Democratic Revolution, the better the conditions for the Socialist Revolution. The experiences of the Chinese Revolution shows that the tasks of the National Democratic Revolution can be fulfilled only through long and torturous struggles. In this stage of revolution, imperialism and its lackeys are the principal enemy. In the struggle against imperialism and its lackeys, it is necessary to rally all the anti-imperialist patriotic forces, including the national bourgeoisie and all patriotic personages. All those patriotic personages from among the bourgeoisie and other exploiting classes who join the anti-imperialist struggle play a progressive historical role. They are not tolerated by imperialism, but welcomed by the proletariat. It is very harmful to confuse the two stages, that is, the National Democratic and the Socialist Revolutions. Comrade Mao Zedong criticized the wrong idea of accomplishing both at one stroke, and pointed out that this utopian idea could only weaken the struggle against imperialism and its lackeys, the most urgent task at that time. The Kuomintang reactionaries and the Trotskyites they hired during the War of Resistance deliberately confused these two stages of the Chinese Revolution, proclaiming the theory of a single revolution and preaching so-called socialism without any Communist Party. Wipe out any revolution to prevent the advance of the National Democratic Revolution, and they used it as a pretext for their non-resistance and capitulation to imperialism. This reactionary theory was buried long ago by the history of the Chinese Revolution. The Khrushchev revisionists are now actively preaching that socialism can be built without the proletariat and without a genuinely revolutionary party armed with the advanced proletarian ideology, and they have cast the fundamental tenets of Marxism-Leninism to the four winds. The revisionists' purpose is solely to divert the oppressed nations from their struggle against imperialism and sabotage their national democratic revolution, all in the service of imperialism. The Chinese Revolution provides a successful lesson for making a thoroughgoing national democratic revolution under the leadership of the proletariat. It likewise provides a successful lesson for the timely transition from the national democratic revolution to the socialist revolution under the leadership of the proletariat. Mao Zedong's thought has been the guide to the victory of the Chinese Revolution. It has integrated the universal truth of Marxism-Leninism with the concrete practice of the Chinese Revolution and creatively developed Marxism-Leninism, thus adding new weapons to the arsenal of Marxism-Leninism. Ours is the epic in which world capitalism and imperialism are heading for their doom, and socialism and communism are marching to victory. Comrade Mao Zedong's theory of people's war is not only a product of the Chinese Revolution, but also has the characteristics of our epic. The new experience gained in the people's revolutionary struggles in various countries since World War II has provided continuous evidence that Mao Zedong's thought is a common asset of the revolutionary people of the whole world. This is the great international significance of the thought of Mao Zedong.